In this episode, we talk about when to start thinking of selling your startup, how to actually sell it, and last but not least, about the taxes and regulation issues.
Learn more about the do's and don'ts in venture capital.
Welcome to episode 8 of this podcast series, Venture Capital Deep Dive. In this podcast, we talk about everything a first-time founder needs to know about the why of a venture capital investor. This podcast is brought to you by B2V Ventures, a Switzerland-based venture capital fund established in 2000 and focused on early-stage startup investing. And I am Cédric Bollock, your host of this podcast and the founder of GlobalTechBooks.com, a video platform focused on insightful interviews with experts around startups, tech, and innovation. Make sure to check them both out. Alexander Stoeckel is a partner at B2V since 2012, board member since 2014, and is actively seeking the best entrepreneurs and most promising startups. You can reach him over LinkedIn and email. In today's episode, we talk about the last stage of the life cycle of a startup when it's all about selling the company. So tell me, when are the first talks of selling a company or going public with the company?
I think the first mentioning of this item will be during the first meeting, either with the VC during the negotiation of the term sheet and due diligence phase, or at the latest during the first meeting after the investment, when the investors and the founders try to think about, where are we taking this company? What will be the exit drivers? Who can be potential acquirers of the company? What are they looking for? Where do we have to take the company, et cetera, et cetera? Generally speaking, an entrepreneur has to understand that the VCs will always be motivated to sell the company at some point because that's how they make money. At the end of the day, it's a question of life and death for a VC to exit his investments, just because then you can generate a return on investment. Then you can generate carried interest and also contribute to the performance of your fund, which will in turn enable you to raise the next fund. So it's not a question of would we like to sell the company. It's really we do like to sell the company, but when and how does this fit with the entrepreneur's understanding?
What is, let's say, for you, I mean, there's only, as far as I know, more or less two or three exit strategies. You close the company, you sell it, or you go public. For the later two, what is more interesting to you and why?
Usually a trade sale is considered to be easier. You have to think less about regulation. You have to spend less on the lawyers, et cetera, et cetera. Plus, you get approached by a company who has a strategic interest to acquire this asset. Whereas on public markets, you can also run into some trouble that is not really related to your company. So maybe markets suffer from some sort of trade war, or the central bank has announced something that has an impact on the stock exchange. And then all of a sudden, what was considered to be a big and successful exit becomes somewhat a failure. So trade sales are usually preferred. There's also the option of buyout, buyback by the founders, but in most cases, that's not a viable option. Also because the money that the VCs would like to get from this exit is bigger than what the founders can afford. So this is in most cases only an option if for some reason the company is on a walking dead level and doesn't really get anywhere, and the VC would like to get out, the founders would like to carry on with it, and then maybe you can reach a deal.
So what is, let's say, for you as a venture capital fund, just so I understand as an entrepreneur, a successful exit?
I think you have to discuss it with the founder. And this is also what I meant with my indication that this may be mentioned in the first discussion with the VC. You try to get an understanding of what the founders are trying to achieve with this company in general. And in most cases, you will find that the exit and the proceeds going from the exit into the founder's pockets are only one part of the game they're playing. They are also into the technology and solving a certain problem and helping customers, et cetera, et cetera. The other question that is discussed between investors and founders is when. Maybe at some point you get approached by potential acquirers, and then the question is, do you accept their offer or do you invest more, take it to the next level, and then eventually sell the company for even more? Common knowledge in venture capital is that money is earned mostly in the very late years of the startup. So in many cases, it's more rewarding to wait another 1 or 2 or 3 years and then sell the company, because then there's even more traction, there's even more money on the table, it's going to be even more attractive. But this, in some cases, can be a problem because lifetime of a fund for a VC is limited, and also founders sometimes would like to get something behind the fire door, if you will. So keep something for yourself, make sure that if we've achieved so much, we've come so far, why don't we just take this offer and then we can do something else? Maybe we can found another company or invest in other companies or et cetera, et cetera. And so this can be very tempting at some point. Last problem that you might face is founders not willing to sell. Sometimes you find that the founders are so proud of their venture, and with all right and with all due respect, I say that they don't want to sell because they see that the moment they sell, they do get a pile of cash on their side, but all of a sudden they are not part of the ecosystem anymore. So right now they are important figures in the ecosystem. They get invited to conferences, they can deliver speeches, they give interviews to newspapers. They play an important role, if you will. And at that very moment when they sell the company, all of a sudden they lose their importance, or maybe they lose their importance. And in some cases, they decide that this is not a good moment to sell and they will stick with the company and not sell. Yeah, and that can be a problem for VCs as well.
Now, as an entrepreneur, especially a first-time founder, and you're sitting in an initial meeting with an investor, you have probably no idea, number one, what IPO stands for, but like you don't really know what the practicality of it means. Like, so what would be the appropriate answer if you have no idea, like, number one, where it's going, what would be the right thing to do? But like you also, like, you don't even know what the practicality means, whether you should be selling or IPOing at some point in the future, which is most likely to be between 5 and 10 years from now.
My personal recommendation would be to take a humorous go at it and say, don't you think this is a bit early to talk about the exit?
Yes.
You haven't yet decided whether you want to invest in the company or not. But I understand what you're saying. So this is how I picture it. I think that we will grow the company in the next 5 years to this and that level of revenues, and we'll have so many users, and we will have sold so many machines. And I think there's a bunch of companies that comes to my mind if I think about potential exit candidates. These are companies XYZ for strategic reasons, companies ABC for financial reasons maybe. I think these would be viable options that we can later on discuss when we get to that point. And I think this would be a good answer, because the VCs in many cases, the reason for us to ask questions is twofold. One reason is we would like to hear the actual answer of the founder. Second, we would like to get an understanding of how well he understands the big picture of his effort in general. So how good is he at thinking about the long-term future of it, the culture, the products, the people, et cetera, and how well does he understand the nitty-gritty today? How deep is he into his business?
Now, when you look at, let's say, a trade sale, when you're trying to sell a company, you very often have the issue, we briefly mentioned it before already, where a founder still feels very, very attached to their company. On the other hand, like the VC has a lifetime that maybe is about to expire, and you have to liquidate certain positions. How do you manage this friction between these two parties, where you actually, in theory, are in the same boat?
So you cannot sell a company against the will of the founder or the founders. You will always have to convince them. This is also why you mentioned it during the first discussions with them, to make sure that you're on the same page and that eventually they would like to get an exit and then do something else with their lives. However, then it really comes down to what could be the ideal process. So if you guys would like to stay with the company, that could be used with a narrative towards potential buyers, because we can say we are interested in selling this asset, but the founders would be more than happy to stay on board and continue to work with the company, either in a C-level function or as members of the board or advisors, et cetera, et cetera. And in many cases, this could be something interesting. And then also in terms of the process, working with an M&A boutique, for example, to say, look, we will not try to sell this company no matter what. We are really looking for the best buyer and the best value. So let's sit down with an M&A boutique of our choice and discuss with them how they see the case. What does their Rolodex say in terms of potential contacts they can reach out to? How can we conduct this entire process? Wouldn't it be nice to have some sort of beauty contest, sort of competition even between potential buyers? to bring in their ideas and offer their tickets, and that we can really take an educated decision and sell the company for the best price to the best guys.
I just want to point out again, like, so the entrepreneurs who are doing it for the first time really understand the interest of a VC. Now, the only way you make money besides making the management fee is the carried interest, which is at some point what you're looking for. Maybe you can explain what happens, like, if they sell the company, when do you make money?
It's also that we have to pay back our fund. So,
yeah, so
we
yeah.
are receiving money from investors. They will invest in the company, let's say in the fund, let's say 500,000. And then we will invest these monies into different companies. And then they will pay management fees for a period of 5 years and then a reduced rate for the next 5 years. And then eventually maybe a very low rate for the last years. At some point, they would like to see their money back and some return on investment. So we have to generate proceeds from our investment activities. And since we don't have dividends in the startup world, we will usually get paid back during the exit process. Therefore, for us, it's really important that we take companies to the exit level, thereby generating paybacks to our funds and then in turn to our limited partners so that we can make them happy and that we can eventually raise the next fund. So for us, it's really a question of life and death.
How long is, like, just for practicality speaking, how long is that process from the moment, let's say, you really sign all the documents of, like, yes, we're selling that position or we're selling that company, till, let's say, the founder gets paid, you get paid, and all the shareholders get their... That their fair
depends,
share.
Can be between 2 months and 12 months, anywhere in between. You're not trying to sell actively in a way. It's like dancing. You like to be asked for a dance and you don't want to go around and ask for partners to dance with you. So you will often sit down with an M&A boutique and discuss with them, how can we play this? Can you reach out to certain people? Can you maybe drop the news that this and that is happening so that they somehow convey the impression that this would be a good moment to take over the company before it becomes too expensive, et cetera, et cetera. I think the subtleties are best managed really by our esteemed friends from the M&A boutiques, because they are very much into this game of playing with different potential buyers and helping you and advising you on how to conduct this process.
Now, talking of the process, who is taking the lead on talking to potential buyers? Who is that, like, who is encouraging... I mean, maybe not encouraging, but maybe really facilitating these conversations with potential buyers.
The M&A boutique will establish the contact and maybe have some preliminary meeting. And then usually the founder and or investors will talk to the buyer. The biggest investors will also be approached by the buyer at some point. And then it really comes down to the individual case. So I don't think there's a golden rule. Again, nothing will happen without the founders, because you cannot sell against the will of the founders.
When you look at, again, from the entrepreneur perspective, again, like, you, if you decided to sell it, then, like, obviously it would be ideal to get the highest price. As an entrepreneur, how many doors should you keep open during this process? Is it, like, something that you have to have, like, a couple of doors, or is it enough if you have just one and then you pretend to have many others? What is kind of, like, best practice, or what have you seen in the market?
I think it's nice to have several doors that are available to you. And the question is always how compelling the narrative might be. So if you can really point out that this would be a very nice complementary element in the business model of company XYZ, potential buyer, for example, and or it could be a very nice addition to the portfolio of profitable companies of financial investor ABC, et cetera, then that would automatically open at least two or three doors. And in most cases, if you find a compelling narrative for one player, you will in parallel find the same door is opening to other players as well, just playing in the same industry and in the same field. But then you have to be careful as well, because if rumor has it that you are about to sell the company and that you're walking around talking to pretty much everybody out there trying to sell the company, this sort of translates into, oh, they are running out of whatever it is, cash ideas, potential in the market, et cetera, et cetera. They seem to be desperate to sell. Again, this is not the impression that you want to convey to the market. It's really a very interesting and subtle process where you talk to some few potential buyers, manage the processes very carefully, also give them the idea of exclusivity. We're talking to you because you seem to be a perfect fit and this is the narrative, et cetera, et cetera, and then take it step by step to the next level. And never never be too needy about it. So if they get the feeling that you have to meet this Tuesday because, I don't know, next Friday you're running out of cash or something, that wouldn't be a good start, right? Yeah. So in the beginning, it should be very aloof and relaxed.
Now, the last part of this episode, I want to dedicate a little bit to taxes and regulations, something that like is probably not the most important, but still important to keep in mind. Also, for all the listeners, important to notice that this is applicable for Switzerland and not all over the world. So maybe take it with a grain of salt. But like maybe what would you recommend to keep in mind when you look at, let's say, the tax perspective of capital gains, specifically for the founders? Also in terms of like how much they have to tax when they own a certain equity at a certain valuation.
I cannot really give specific tax advice. The standard process would always be to recommend to the founders, meet a tax advisor relatively early on and think about how you can structure this. And this is not during the exit period, by the way. This is happening during the Series A and Series B, maybe. Mm-hmm. Just sit down with them and think about what are you trying to do in the future with your life? Like not only in terms of spending the proceeds on cars or something, but also, are you willing to do more investments in the future, for example, or do you plan to just stay with the company and never really cash out everything, but always be some sort of shareholder in the company? How can we structure this? Do we need a special purpose vehicle for that? Or should you invest or be the shareholder individually? And that can depend from person to person and also where you want to spend your life, whether it's in Switzerland, whether it's in other European countries, et cetera, et cetera. So it's really complicated, I think. And the tax lawyers, tax consultants will get paid as sort of an insurance fee, if you will. So they will recommend a certain strategy and you can hold them liable based on their advice because you've paid for that and that's what they recommended, and therefore that's a good solution to make sure that not too much goes wrong in that direction.
Like what could go wrong? That would have been my last
question. That you get unforeseeable tax payments, that you get somehow punished for not structuring it this way or that way. I have no knowledge of any examples where that was a big problem, so I don't think this is going to be a major issue. The problem is really to get the company to that level and then sell it successfully.
Thank you so much for being part of this special video series, and I hope this will help many first-time founders and founders in general to understand what to look out for when getting an investment from a VC. Thank you so much for listening, and I hope to see you another time.
Thank you.